welcome to another book unpacking video. Making my way through my big pile of boxes that have my books. It is a rather bright but overcast afternoon. There is snow on the ground outside, and I have a fire going in my wood stove, so you might hear some popping and crackling once in a while. I suppose I'll get started here. Started here. This is a book that I've featured in a couple previous videos. It is the graphic novel of The Last Unicorn. Beautiful book. Definitely recommend it if you can find it, although commenter alerted me to the situation that it is apparently difficult to locate a copy of this because it's out of print. So that's sad to hear. There was some unpleasant drama with the publisher and the rights, and I'm not sure what else. It's a shame because it's beautiful. So maybe someday it can be reprinted. Next one. This is The Wisdom of Insecurity by Alan Watts. Alan Watts was a philosopher during the 1960s and 70s, who was somewhat famous for bringing Eastern philosophies, Zen and Buddhism and such, to a Western audience, popularizing it and communicating some of the ideas in a way that a Western culture could understand and resonate with. And I went through a phase where I was really, really into some of his stuff and his conceptualizations of the self. As an example, as a matter of fact, you cannot compare this present experience with a past experience. You can only compare it with a memory of the past, which is a part of the present experience. When you see clearly that memory is a form of present experience, it will be obvious that trying to separate yourself from this experience is as impossible as trying to make your teeth bite themselves. One. Oh. to My Little Pony. Is it a comic? It is a comic. I don't even know if I've read this. I forgot, I forgot that they even had comics. I'm sure that this was given to me. Maybe I should revisit it to see if I remember anything about it. Oh. Life of Pi by Yann Martell. Which is funny, because this is also Life of Pi by Yann Martell. See, this is why it's a good thing that I'm doing this in a slow, careful manner, because then I get to discover that I have two copies of the same book. I guess I should do something with one of these copies. I wonder why I have two. Where did I get the second one? Why did I get the second one? This is Preludes and Nocturnes, which is it's one of the books in the Sandman comic series. And I don't remember, is this the second book? Oh, maybe this is the first. Oh, this is the first book. Yeah. This is the first book. Which is my absolutely least favorite of the entire Sandman series. I don't like the last act of it. But you gotta get through it to get to the rest of it, to get to the really good stuff. Dragons of a Fallen Sun. I think I bought this in the tail end of my Dragonlance phase, which lasted through most of my adolescence. And it's been so long since I was into Dragonlance. I don't remember the main series. There were some series of books that were like the core Dragonlance books, and then they had like a wide range of side stories, side characters, and then I think this was meant to be a sequel to some of the main storyline books. I guess this series is called The War of Souls. But I think my emotional investment in this series was sort of closed out after the Twins trilogy. Which were about Caramon and Raistlin. My two favorite characters from Dragonlance, Tasselhoff and Raistlin. And they didn't get to interact together very much, really, but when they did, it was delightful. This was a comic book that was gifted to me from someone who knows the comic world much better than I, and who enjoys Grant Morrison, who is the person who wrote this. Yes. I think Grant Morrison is, like, they're fairly prolific, I believe. I don't know much about them, but this is a comic book about animals who are highly intelligent. What's it called? We Three. You can see the title there, but it's hard to parse. So it looks like the main characters are a cat, a dog, and a rabbit. They are wearing mech suits, which is so cute. It's cute, but I think the story itself is grim, and it looks like it from the various forms of violence I'm seeing here. It's been a while since I read this. Oh, I think I remember it being good. All Creatures Great and Small by James Herriot. This is a very old copy. It originally came, or I don't know about originally, but it wound its way to the Gresham Book Exchange in Graham, Oregon. But that must have been long before I picked up this copy, because I got this when I was a kid, so this book has been on a bit of a journey. Published in 1972, and it looks like maybe this printing was in 1975. So this is part of a series by James Herriot, which is a fictionalized autobiography of a veterinarian who works on animals, helps animals, and I remember it being very heartwarming, very earnest. But I haven't read it since I was a kid. He's doing things like delivering baby animals, probably doing surgeries and such. I think farm animals mostly. He lives in the countryside. This is a Luis Royo. Luis Royo is an artist. This is put out as part of the heavy metal series. This is, if I remember correctly, pretty saucy art. I won't show this one on camera, but more cool art from the 80s, probably 80s. Let's see. No, this was published in the 90s. Early 90s, but it doesn't... I'm just inferring that from the jacket summary of the author, the illustrator. Ray Bradbury, Fahrenheit 451. Classic. It's about a dystopian future where books are illegal and they get burned. And it's about, and the main character is a fireman, but not a firefighter. It's a guy who his job is to burn books. And no spoilers, but he experiences a paradigm shift throughout the course of the book. I remember it being good. Ray Bradbury is pretty much always good. You might have read this one in school. It's a popular one for that. This is another Sandman book, comic book. This is actually the very last book in the Sandman series. I guess I own the first book and the last book, but I don't know if I own any of the ones in between. I love the art in this one. It's a very interesting style. There's Delirium. Little fairy costume. Sphere by Michael Crichton. Crichton is an author that I enjoyed when I was, I don't know how old exactly, like 14, 15, 16. And he writes science fiction books that are very exciting. Like reading one of Michael Crichton's books feels like watching an action movie. So that's why I enjoy his work. He's the one who wrote Jurassic Park, which you may have heard of. And this one, Sphere, is about a mysterious object found under a deep, deep, deep in the ocean. And it has various mysterious properties. I don't think I read this since I was a teenager, so I don't quite remember anything about it, but fun book to read. Here's another heavy metal published book. This one is not safe for work, but this is a calendar. Let's see if I can show you. Okay, here's it. It's falling apart, but it's like a planner. Oh, and I guess it was from 1999, because here it says 292 days to 2000, 291 days to 2000, 290 days to 2000. So you can count down the days to the year 2000. While you enjoy sci-fi illustrations from various artists. I'm trying to find another one that I can put on the video, but it's not working. Okay. Hmm. is the ear, the eye, and the arm, which is a science fiction, cyberpunk? I don't know. Definitely science fiction book that takes place in Zimbabwe. And it is about three children who get kidnapped and the three detectives who have to, who track them down. The detectives are named the ear, the eye, and the arm for their, for the special mutations that they have that make them uniquely qualified to track down missing persons, for example. And this was a book I read over and over and over again as a kid. Lost my copy of it somewhere along the way, then remembered the book existed when I was an adult and found a copy online, and read it and found out that it was just as good as I remembered. I love it when that happens. Highly, highly recommend this book. It's, it reads like an adventure book, but it has an unusual amount of depth for young adult novel, I think. And it has a lot of interesting cultural aspects to it, and how the sci-fi elements kind of integrate with the culture and the spirituality in it. It's very interesting. This one is called Future Ability, The Age of Impotence and the Horizon of Possibility. The jacket's torn here. It's unfortunate. I should fix that. And I don't think I've read this. This looks like something maybe I picked up at a thrift store and then didn't get around to reading. Excerpt from a random page. Is madness an exceptional occurrence that looms at the margins of the rational and reasonable daily business of life? Is it an inescapable disturbance of the ongoing conversation that holds society together? Madness should not be seen as an accident to hide or fix. Madness is the background of evolution, the chaotic matter that we are modeling and transforming into a provisional order. Order here means a shared illusion of predictability, of regularity, a projective illusion that can hold for a short or a long period of time, a few minutes or perhaps centuries, an illusion that gives birth to what we call civilization. We must distinguish two phases of madness. One is the factual meaninglessness of the world, the surrounding magma of matter, the uncontrollable proliferation of stimuli, the dazzling whirl of existence. This madness is the precondition of the creation of meaning, the groundless construction of knowledge, the invention of the world as a meaningful whole. Then there is the subjective side of madness, the painful sentiment that things are flying away, the feeling of being overwhelmed by speed and noise and violence, of anxiety, panic, mental chaos. Pain forces us to look for an order to the world that we cannot find because it does not exist. Yet this craving for order does exist. It is the incentive to build a bridge across the abyss of entropy, a bridge between different singular minds. From this conjunction, the meaning of the world is evoked and enacted, shared semiosis, breathing in consonance. seems probably good. I don't really know what it's about, but that gives an idea as to the topic a little bit. Well, this comes from, how old is this? 2017. On the Road by Tanith Lee. Over the last little while, whenever I visit a used bookstore, I've been looking for anything I can find by Tanith Lee, because there's a lot of her work that hasn't been digitized and made available in ebook format. And she's such a wonderful writer that I know her stuff won't be lost, but I want to make sure to just keep a copy if I can of her things. I don't remember if this one is a book of stories or is a novel. I might not have read this one yet. There was actually one book of hers that I stopped reading because it wasn't to my taste, but that's only happened once with hers. She writes just magnificently, beautifully poetic prose, lots of wonderful themes in her stories. Called Antibodies by David J. Skull, and it's part of a series called Isaac Asimov Presents, which I would guess mean that it's got an introduction by Isaac Asimov, so I guess at some point in his career he curated other works of science fiction. But I haven't read this. Oh, interesting. This is... Oh, so it's about transhumanism, looks like. They were born meat, but as members of the shadowy cybernetic temple, they vowed to explode the barrier between man and machine. Like transsexuals who feel trapped in the body of the opposite sex, these antibodies seek to replace their bodies completely, a piece at a time if necessary, to escape their prisons of flesh. Are their operations what they seem, the next evolutionary step toward immortality? Or are the antibodies being exploited for the purpose of ruthless medical and corporate experimentation? This sounds cool. Maybe I'll read it someday. Who knows? It is a rather disturbing common pattern on my bookshelf to have books I haven't read. I don't like that. But also, it's painful to get rid of books that look like something I want to read and just haven't yet. Don't know how to solve that problem. This is called African Genesis by Robert Ardrey, a personal investigation into the animal origins and nature of man. African Genesis presents a fascinating array of new scientific evidence, largely accumulated over the past 30 years. This was published in the 1960s, so using information from the 1930s to the 1960s. It is the author's unorthodox and intriguing theory that Homo sapiens developed from carnivorous predatory killer apes, and that man's age-old affinity for war and weapons is the natural result of this inherited animal instinct. Not to be dismissive or anything, but it definitely sounds like the work of someone who's trying to reconcile a post-World War II world. But it probably has some interesting information in here too. Haven't read it. I don't know if I will. Don't know where it came from. John Steinbeck of Mice and Men. It's just it's a classic, but it's a small book. It's basically a novella. Heartbreaking novella, be warned. But it's an easy read. Supremacy's Shadow. This was written by a friend of mine, and he published this book, and so I bought a copy. It has a little message in me for it. Has a little message to me in it. I think maybe we had some sort of agreement that I must not have purchased it. He must have sent it to me, and I think maybe in exchange for a review. That sounds about right. It is a sci-fi action novel. And it can be very cool to read a book that an acquaintance wrote. You get a glimpse into their imagination in a way, in their mind in a way that you just can't get through just normal hanging out and conversation. Often, you know, whole other sides to people. Another Tamith Lee book from my scrounging used bookstores efforts. Dark Castle, White Horse. Not only does it look like I have not read this one, it feels like no one has read this one. It is old. This was printed in 1986, but the pages feel stiff. The spine is unbent. I do read Tamith Lee books, so there is a chance I will read this one. Let's put this with the other one. This is a book called Beautiful Darkness. I think I participated in a Kickstarter for this one. And it is about a bunch of tiny little creatures that live in the forest and think the main it's very cute and lovely, but it also gets very grim and violent. So these tiny people, they live in the forest, and I think what I remember from this is them, they find a dead body in the forest, and they use it as, I think, maybe shelter or resources. And there's also various personal conflicts, and I don't know, it's got the feel of a children's book, but I don't think it's for children. I don't think children should read it. But it's an interesting contrast between lighthearted and dark-hearted material. Another classic that I originally read in school, The Lord of the Flies by William Golding. You may have come across this in school as well. It's about a plane crashes on an island, and the occupants of the plane were all boys from a boys' school, and they have to survive on the island, and it depicts them navigating various circumstances and dividing into different social groups and power dynamics, and something, I think, of an effort to try to illustrate human nature through using children as something of a blank slate. Children as a blank slate, and then a deserted island as another blank slate, and exploring what sorts of unpleasantness might arise within human behavior as a result of that. This is a photo book. It's called Our Century in Pictures for Young People. So I'm no longer allowed to read this book, but it's a history book using photography. And we can do that now. Photography has been around long enough that we can have a century's worth of historic documentation and photography. My turn. Cool. This is a Myst book. So there's the Myst games, obviously, but they also released a series of novels. This part of the cover has been chewed on by a rodent, especially back in the day. There were a lot of my belongings that got a little bit chewed by my pet rats. Anyway, So this series tells about the history of Atrus and his family. It's longer than I remember. I don't know if I read the whole series. This one is called The Book of Tiana. So really fleshes out and explores the lore in the Mist Games. Four Agreements. I remember being given this book. It's just a small little self-help book about making agreements with yourself, I believe. And I think the premise is if you make these agreements with yourself, it is a path to peace, inner peace. Looks like the agreements are: be impeccable with your word, don't take anything personally, don't make assumptions, and always do your best. And it talks about how to conceptualize those ideas and probably provides advice as to how to make and keep those types of agreements. I was probably about, it says 2007, so I was 21? 20? A little note from my mom who gave it to me. This is another book by James Herriot in that same series from earlier. It's about the veterinarian. So together, these books are All Things Wise and Wonderful, All Creatures Great and Small. These are lyrics to a song and potentially a scripture passage. It is just a song. By Cecil Francis Alexander. There's a third book in the series as well that I probably don't have, but I guess I'll find out. This is The Phantom Tollbooth by Norton Juster. This is a fantasy novel, a children's fantasy novel, about a young boy who, I think he finds like a toy car in an attic, and then he starts driving it, and it takes him to another world. Yeah. For Milo, everything's a bore. When a toll booth mysteriously appears in his room, he drives through only because he's got nothing better to do. But on the other side, things seem different. Milo visits the Island of Conclusions, you can get there by jumping, learns about time from a ticking watchdog named Talk, and even embarks on a quest to rescue rhyme and reason. Somewhere along the way, Milo realizes something astonishing. Life is far from dull. In fact, it's exciting beyond his wildest dreams. I don't know if this book is still in print. I remember it being really good, so I hope it is. This is Summer in Orcus by T. Kingfisher, otherwise known as Ursula Vernon, who I may have mentioned once or twice before. This is a story about a girl who also goes to another world. There's my cat. Summer is a perfectly ordinary 11-year-old girl with a perfectly ordinary, needy, overprotective single mother. Summer loves her mother and would never dream of running away, but wonders if it wouldn't be nice to escape for a little while and do something adventurous. Then Baba Yaga comes along in her magical walking house and offers Summer her heart's desire. Summer has no idea what this might be, but with the lightning... With the lighting of a frog-shaped beeswax candle, she finds herself transported to the strange world of Orcus, with nothing but a weasel in her pocket. I think I remember Ursula Vernon mentioning that... This was sort of her response to a Narnia book. Hey, stop. I think these days the kids are calling it isekai. So this is a completely...
Hey!
Oh my goodness. Alright, we'll take a break to appreciate your purring. Here. This is a copy of the book Xenocide by Orson Scott Card. I have no idea what happened to it. It might have even been like this before I ever picked it up. It says it's no longer the property of Layton High School. This is the third in the Ender's Game series. I think it's the third. Might be the fourth. Which I read when I was in high school. And after the first Ender's Game book, Ender grows up and is an adult. So this is also following that. following that story. I think it has some interesting pieces in it, but nothing in this series was ever as good as the first book, Ender's Game. Douglas Adams, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Classic, funny, staple of sci-fi humor. This particular copy was published in 1982. I've read the full series once, and I think this book probably a few times. The other two things in here are not books, they are games. So it looks like I've got Minecraft and The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. They are both Switch games from when I first got my Switch Lite a little while ago. And Breath of the Wild, I played a lot on the Switch. Minecraft, I just got picked up so that I could play with my friends if I didn't have a computer handy. Yeah, so these don't belong on a bookshelf, but I don't know where to put them. Figure it out. Thank you for joining me as I continue to try to find space for all my books and rediscover which books I have. Hope you'll join me for the next unpacking videos. And in the meantime, be well. See you later.